almost pre-professionally until I was 12 at a studio that was more balancing based and really geared towards School of American Ballet. And then my family decided to move. And for me, that was a huge tragedy because I couldn't believe it. I wanted to be a ballerina and hear why family was moving to Austin, Texas. And when we moved to Austin, there was no ballet. But I told my parents, I'm not going to school, I just want to dance ballet. And so I enrolled in homeschool online, and I just turned on YouTube and just would watch Russian ballerinas, and I got obsessed. And I would go to my ballet classes, and I'd hate it because it wasn't what I was seeing on these videos. And my mom, one day, she got lost, and she found this Russian teacher who was teaching Bolshoi curriculum. And I started training with her, and then I did YGP. And then I auditioned for the Kirov School in Washington, D.C., and I moved to Kirov. I studied there for 2 years, and that's really sort of where I got my base and got used to living away from home. And then I moved from there. I took a master class in New York, and a teacher, who just happened to be a teacher at Bolshoi Ballet Academy, saw me. And she said, you should come to the school. And I said, okay, I will. And they accepted me. And then I went to the summer school in New York, and my teacher, who would be my teacher in Russia, chose me to dance Pahita, and the director chose me to join the school in the Russian course. So I was one of the first American girls to really get to be inside a Russian class, which was very different. And I had moved to Russia, and I didn't speak any Russian. I had to learn when I got there. And I was in a Russian class, and my teacher told me, you know, if you don't speak Russian in 2 months, I'm going to kick you out. Gonna go to the foreigners class. So I had to wake up every day at 5 a.m. and stretch and try and learn Russian because I didn't have any turnout. I was so behind the other girls technically, and I could do turns and things like that, but I couldn't do a first position, how I was trying to teach you guys today. So that was a very hard time. And then in the second course, I was very lucky that the school believed in me and they gave me a lot of roles. And I got to do solo parts almost right away, as well as Porto Ballet stuff in the school. And then we went all around Europe sort of touring. And in my final year, actually my second year, I was chosen to dance in the Kennedy Center with their proteges, which was incredible because at age 16, you know, it's very difficult to dance a pas de deux in front of many people, especially in a place like Washington. And Washington, D.C. is where I left because I lived there for 2 years. And then I came back to Russia for my final year, and I was chosen to dance La Fima Verde on the Bolshoi stage, the Bolshoi production of La Fima Verde. And then then I went to Paris, and I won my first competition, the Youth American Grand Prix. And then after that, I danced Pahita, and I graduated on the Bolshoi historical stage, the first time the school had danced on that historical stage. And after graduation, I joined the Bolshoi, where I danced for 2 years. And after 2 years, I changed companies, and now I moved to the Kremlin. I had to start all over, and I was promoted to principal at 19, completely out of the blue. And that's where I am right now. So I'm dancing there still at the Kremlin. But I danced all over the world for different galas. I've got a partner who is incredible, and he's taught me so much, and I'm still learning, and I'm still trying to grow. So I'm definitely still in the process where I work with the teacher every day, individually, for 2 hours. So we're definitely, I'm not a finished product at all. I'm definitely still in my process. So that's a little bit about me. Well, I'm 21, old woman, but
that's interesting.
Okay.
Did you break your foot?
Did I
break
my what?
Did you break your foot?
Did I break my foot? I did break, I've had many injuries, well, not many, but I've struggled with stress fractures. And my problem with stress fractures are really interesting because a lot of times you think you can work through stress fractures, but you can't. So what I did was I was working on a stress fracture that was diagnosed, and then I had a compound fracture. I had that surgery because piece of the bone broke off, and in the United States, they reattached that part of the bone, but in Russia, they decided to remove it, and actually, that turned out to be the wiser choice, because I was able to keep dancing and not not have to do all the rehabilitation that it takes to regrow a bone. So if you have a stress fracture, just rest in a boot for 6 weeks. Don't push. You're done for 6 weeks. Time out. There's no ands, ifs, whats. Oh, I'm going to do Pilates on the side. No. You're going to be in a boot for 6 weeks, and that's it. Don't mess around with injuries. What? A stress fracture?
Yes.
You need to know your limits, and you need to work anatomically correctly so that you can listen to your teacher. I saw everybody today is rolling here. You need to make sure this bone is lifted, because when you lift this bone, you're lifting the tendons in your feet, you're engaging the muscles, and you're supporting the bones. When you're letting this go, you're letting all the tendons and muscles go in your feet, and your feet are just, they're not absorbing shock anymore. Your body's incredible. It can absorb shock. Leg. Yes?
How many years in total have you done some professional
thing? I'm coming up on my third or fourth year. Yeah, which is crazy.
This is your second year.
Yeah. Second year of tennis. Yeah. Fourth year professionally. Which is extremely different than being in school.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever done dancing in Asia for an extended period of time?
In Asia?
Yeah.
That's like my dream. I won against in China and in Hong Kong and Singapore. I love Asia so much. What? Dance in Brush Fight is extremely difficult because I was the only girl out of my class to be chosen for the whole show, and there were 10 or 15 girls in my class and my parallel. So it's an extreme, you have to get the top grades in the class, and not only the last year, you have to get it the whole time, you have to be dancing, solos, parts. And then you have to go to the audition, and they have to keep you there. Mm-hmm. It's really difficult. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What bothered you the most when you were a kid?
What bothered me the most?
What motivated you the most?
I think what motivated me the most, probably, this is going to be a little bit of a deeper answer, but the fear of failure. I had six brothers and two sisters, and it was really hard for my parents to give each and every one of us attention, so I didn't want to start on something and have to come home to my parents and say I failed at it. But then, I guess what motivated me is the love of dancing and just the pursuit of unattainable perfection. Yeah, it's a bit broader, but... yeah.
Is it true that this would be a movie?
What?
Is it true that this would be a movie?
So there's a couple things in the works right now. I don't know if I'm like allowed to talk about it openly, but there was a movie being planned to film about my life at Bolshoi. And then there's a documentary coming out, which I recommend the documentary because with movies they like to play around with your life and do weird things, and I'm like, that never happened. Oh, but it's good for the script, you know. My life.
Is everyone's life good enough?
But I think the documentary will be really interesting because they are still following me, and they followed me since my second year of school. So it'll be really fun.
So Joy, what exactly is life in Russia like for you? Mm-hmm. Every day, every week, is it difficult?
I think that when you make a transition from being a student to a professional, when you're a student, the environment is provided for you. As a professional dancer, you decide what your environment is. For me, I decided to create an almost impossible environment. But, I mean, I like to work, wake up in the morning at around 5:45. I like to go to the gym, I like to work out, I like to stretch, I like to get to the studio early. I like to spend time when I'm not in rehearsals working on my business things, making YouTube videos as some of you guys have seen. And I love being involved with my friends in my Bible study. And I think it's really important to have a community, regardless of where you are. And I think that it's important to get out and travel the world as well, because you can get a different perspective. So that's kind of what my life is like. It's very intense, but at the same time, I love to get out and sort of change it all up. So I'm always looking for new ways to be better. Oh, okay.
I mean, that's your business.
Yes.
Can you tell us more about it?
So, for most of us dancers, and I have to commend every single one of you guys here, it's beautiful. But for a lot of dancers, it can be a huge struggle to maintain the aesthetic line, because if we're honest, ballet is very aesthetic based. And I struggled my whole life with eating disorders, especially after moving to Russia, and there is your weight every week, and there is a bottom line of how much you should weigh. And I struggled, after struggling for so many years, I wanted to have a product that would be sort of not an answer, an all-encompassing answer, but something that you could eat and trust that you weren't going to gain weight, you're going to be fueled the right way, you're not going to be hungry, and you're going to be ready to go, and you won't feel weighed down. Because for me, my argument with my parents when they saw me losing so much weight was saying, hey, but I don't like to eat before I go to ballet class because I have to look at myself in the mirror. So I wanted something, I wanted the impossible. And I think this bar is close there. I eat them and I don't feel weighed down. And they're gluten-free, they're paleo, they have the right amount of protein, carbohydrates, sugar balance. It's so important to be fueling yourself, especially if you're in the studio, in the right way. And a lot of us dancers, when we're training as students, we're eating junk food, we're eating crap. And then if we have a problem weight-wise, we go extreme in the opposite. So this is an answer, and it, I would hope would be a tool that dancers, young dancers, could use to train themselves how to fuel yourself in the right way. Your body is your tool. So don't treat it in a mean way. When you do all of those, when you overeat or if you undereat, you're mistreating your body. You're mistreating your tool, your thing that you have that is so beautiful and can give so much joy to so many people. In company life? In student life, it's all based on who's getting a job, and it's very competitive in that way. And it's very, you've got feedback from your teacher, so you know what you need to work on. And in a company, it's a luxury to have somebody there telling you what you need to work on. You are your own boss, and nobody's handing you the keys to the kingdom like they were when you were a student. And so you either are going to be strong enough to rise to the challenge and the politics and the complications of company life, or you're not. There's no safety net. In school, you've got your parents, you've got your teachers, you've got your community, and in a company, it's just yourself. There's no team atmosphere in a company. People are rooting for you to fail. That's the honest position. You've got probably five or six people who want you to fall down on the ground. Lot better off. It's extremely difficult if you don't want it.